on something else. So there's a kind of emotional woundedness in being in this room again. And I do want to say right at the beginning, lest there be any misapprehension, that while I seize the privilege of being able to come today, I hope no one thinks that I masquerade as an expert of any kind, either on Scottish church history or Scottish theology. I'm an expert in neither, but an amateur in the profoundest sense in both. And it's partly for that reason that I chose to give the lecture this afternoon. Come in, there is still room to spare, on William Chalmers Burns, because he is a man who has interested me, along with his colleagues, some of them more familiar, many of them less familiar to us, from the first half, especially, of the 19th century. Let me begin by inviting you, if you like to do this, to close your eyes for a moment and imagine that you are on board the sailing ship Mary Bannatyne on the 9th of June in 1847. She's moored in the harbour at Portsmouth, and in one of the small cabins there, two brothers are praying together and reading scripture. The older brother reads from John 17, and then from 2 Timothy chapter 4, from verse 10. And he closes the scripture reading by saying to his brother, the last words are, "Salute Prisca." And referring to his mother, he says to his younger brother, Eily Burns, "You must do this for me, because I am not able." Eily Burns, who, as you know, wrote his biography, also a biography of the father, William Hamilton Burns, later found in the trash can a scrunched up version of a letter that William Chalmers Burns had tried to write, essentially a farewell letter of affection and love to his mother. The brothers prayed again and presumably embraced one another. Eily Burns disembarked and watched the Mary Bannatyne sail out of Portsmouth Harbour on the beginning of its five-month journey to China, fully expecting that this would be the last time he would see his brother. Missionary life today is still sacrificial, but not remotely as sacrificial as it was in those days when men and women went elsewhere to bury themselves and to die. And in many ways, this marks the hinge point in William Chalmers Burns' life. It can be divided fairly neatly into three segments. The first segment, through the time of his licensing as a gospel minister in 1839. The second segment, when he spent about 8 years as an itinerant preacher in Scotland and England, in Ireland, and also a spell in Canada. And then the final section, 21 years from the time in 1850 to the time when he died, eventually as a 53-year-old man. 21 years living in China, coming home to accompany a sick and bereaved missionary for a matter of a number of months in the middle of his service. Originally, my intention was to speak about that latter part of his life, the 21 years in China, which are perhaps less well known to us. And the more I thought about it, the more I felt, in order to understand Burns in China, we need to try and understand Burns, first of all, in Scotland. There was an additional element in that, that Burns was not sent to China by anyone in Scotland, but by the Presbyterian Church in England. And so I wasn't sure that his 21 years in China qualified as part of Scottish church history or Scottish church theology. But the more important reason is that it's the earlier period of his life that helps us to see what it was that made Chalmers Burns the servant of God that he came to be. And so I want to look at that first section of his life until he's sailing off to China in 1847 in three sections. First of all, to talk about Burns being awakened. Second, to talk about Burns and the awakening, especially in 1839. And then thirdly, to try and think together a little with you about Burns the Awakener. So Burns awakened, Burns and the Awakening, and Burns the Awakener. William Chalmers Burns was born in the manse of Dun, just outside Montrose in Angus, on the 1st of April 1815. His father, William Hamilton Burns, was the local minister. Burns was the fifth of 10 children, the first and the last, both boys called John, who died in infancy. And he was reared for the first few years of his life there in the manse of Dun. The father, William, was said to be a faithful pastor, not a familial, jovial father, but also a faithful father. Certainly he apparently read with the boys for half an hour, first thing in the morning. He prayed with them. They read books together as a family, Pilgrim's Progress, which Burns later translated into Chinese, being a great favorite. And he catechized them and prayed with them at the end of the Lord's Day, every Sunday evening. The other brothers and sisters were much engaged in the life of the church, the sisters marrying ministers. Burns, of course, probably grew up in the parish of Dun with tales of George Wishart, who had been Erskine of Dun's schoolmaster, probably the first schoolmaster in Scotland to teach pupils Greek so that they could learn to read the New Testament for themselves, and also doubtless tales of John Knox, who had spent a month in 1555 in the house of Erskine of Dun. And then they moved to Kilsyth. I've very little doubt that part of the attraction of that for Burns Sr. was the stories he'd heard of the Cambus Lang work and the Kilsyth Awakening in 1742. He found Kilsyth a welcoming place, but in the ups and downs of pastoral ministry, he increasingly came to be concerned about the spiritual lukewarmness. 1832, there was a cholera epidemic in Scotland. The people of Kilsyth feared that it would come to them. They came frequently and many numbers for prayer. And then when the cholera epidemic swung past Kilsyth, the prayer meetings began to ebb, the enthusiasm for seeking God's face began to dissipate, and Burns Sr. began to urge on the people the necessity of prayer for God to do a fresh work of awakening. There was actually one prayer meeting, an elders' prayer meeting in the parish that had gone on continuously since 1842. And Burns sought to build on that. He would read frequently from James Robe's account of the events that took place in Kilsyth in 1742. And so William Chalmers Burns was nurtured and nourished, godly home, loving, faithful parents, brothers and sisters. He was an outside boy. His younger brother said he was more likely to be a hunter than a scholar. He could walk the hind legs off a donkey. It was nothing to him to walk 30, 40 miles during the day. His highest aspiration was to be a farmer. He was taught in the local school by a man who rejoiced in the name of Alex Salmond. And then he had the opportunity to go to what then was fairly distinguished grammar school of Aberdeen. Went as a young boy, and then on to one of the two universities that Aberdeen boasted in those days, as many universities as the whole of England, to Marshall College, and began to study for his arts degree. And then, for a variety of reasons, took an interest in the law. The chief personal reasons seem to have been that in his mid-teens he began to notice that lawyers lived in big houses and they had much better salaries than parish ministers like his father. And so he was apprenticed in Edinburgh to his uncle. And all of this made his family, the spiritually minded members of the family, anxious about Burns' spiritual condition. Two of his sisters wrote to him, underlining to him they did not want to be in heaven without their brother. And somewhat to their surprise, Burns wrote back and asked them if there was something that they could suggest he would read. They sent him a copy of Thomas Boston's Human Nature in its Fourfold State. He read other things. He was under a faithful ministry in Edinburgh. And then one day, out of the blue, he appeared in the manse in Kosyth. He was ushered into the dining room. The family was gathered. His mother naturally hustled in and said to him, "Willie, where have you come from?" He said, "From Edinburgh." He'd walked 36 miles earlier on the day from Edinburgh. And anxious, obviously, in her face, Burns immediately said to her, "What would you think, Mama, if I became a minister after all?" And he had been marvelously brought to faith in Jesus Christ. He says, "I felt that now he was in his own sovereignty, touching my heart and drawing me to himself for his own glory." Speculative, but it's easy to speculate that one of the obstacles in his mind about the costliness of following Jesus Christ was probably the thought that it might mean he would need to become a minister. And now his life was yielded to Jesus Christ. He returned to Aberdeen. Despite his brother's statements, he turned out to be an excellent student. He graduated with distinction. He was a fine mathematician, as a surprising number of these 19th century worthies were, intellectually capable, tremendously personally disciplined. But unlike the other names, most of whom are familiar to us in the McShane Bonner circle, he decided to continue his studies not here in Edinburgh, but in Glasgow. That, it needs to be said, was a providential move on his part, although even as a Glaswegian, I have to say, it was not to his academic advantage. The church history lectures were described as walking into the cave of Morpheus. The Hebrew professor was said to be an intelligent enough man, but quotes, "he knew almost nothing of Hebrew," putting him in the same category as most of his students. One thing that was outstanding in Glasgow University in those days was the Greek department. And Burns was an enthusiastic student of antiquity and the classics. He won a prize medal for an essay on the characteristics of Hellenistic Greek. And he maintained that interest all his life. He had an unusual ability, it seems to me, to relax, quite unusual ability to relax. And one of the ways in which he relaxed all through his life was by reading the Greek classics. The other was by sleeping. He had no false piety about sleeping. He regards sleeping as a spiritual duty for a busy gospel minister. But the thing that was most significant in those days was that the minister of the Milton Church was John Rabbi Duncan. And young Burns attached himself to Rabbi Duncan's ministry. And it was, I think, largely from Rabbi Duncan that he learned Hebrew sufficiently well in later years to be able to substitute for Duncan when Duncan was ill and wasn't able to teach his Hebrew classes. And most of all, to profit spiritually from that unusual genius of a man. Later on in his itinerant days, after the awakening in Kosyth and then in Dundee, Burns spent a number of months centered on John Milne's congregation, St. Leonard's in Perth, and at the end of his last sermon to them, he said this: "If you have got any good from my teaching, you may trace it under the Lord's hand to that man of God in Glasgow, John Duncan." Well, as a student, he'd become interested in the missionary society, took an active part in it, and began to feel himself drawn to overseas missions. It was at one of these meetings in 1838 that he heard a physician from Kilmarnock, Dr. Halley, speak about his hopes of going to China. Burns himself was slowly heading mentally towards India. As it happened in the providence of God, Callie was too sick to go to China, but this man who had prompted the interest, in a sense, was part of the catalyst in God's economy in eventually bringing William Chalmers Burns to China. Those who knew him at this time said that he was obviously an earnest Christian, but there was nothing extraordinary about him, nothing that would make him stand out from the crowd. Yet, clearly, there was a double burden beginning to develop in Burns' life. And you would almost be able to guess what that burden was. It was, first of all, a burden for the lost and for bringing the gospel to them. I don't mean by that, and this is really a key to Burns, I don't mean by that that he loved to preach evangelistic sermons, which he did, but that he really had a burden for the lost that went through the whole of his being. And he had a real evangelistic life and lifestyle. One day his mother saw him in the Argyll Arcade in Glasgow. And he didn't notice her, so she went over to speak to him, and he said this to her: "Oh, mother," he said, "when walking along Argyll Street just now, I was so overcome with the sight of the countless crowds of immortal beings eagerly hustling hither and thither, but all posting onwards towards the eternal world, that I could bear it no longer and turned in here to seek relief in quiet thought." Quite reminiscent of the much better known words of Murray McChain, aren't they? "As I was walking through the fields today, that thought came to me with almost overwhelming power, that those to whom I preach must shortly go to either heaven or hell." And alongside that burden for the lost was a new catalyst of intercessory prayer. One of his letters to his sister Jane, he writes that he has been guilty of a great and fundamental error, of having too few and too short periods of solemn retirement with our gracious Father. For here we learn the depravity of our hearts and the wonder of his grace. Well, at the end of his studies, Burns was licensed on the 27th of March, 1839, by the Presbytery of Glasgow. The plan was at the time that he would possibly go to Canada, believe it or not, to gain pastoral experience, and then on from Canada to India. The committee eventually decided, you can understand, that that wasn't quite such a bright idea, although he did eventually go to Canada. And it was just at this time that the invitation came from Murray McChain to fill his pulpit while McChain and Bonner, along with Dr. Black and Dr. Keith of St. Cyrus, were making their journey through Europe, investigating the situation of the Jewish populations and eventually to Jerusalem. And it was in that context, mediated, I think, probably through Burns' childhood, McShane's childhood friend, Alexander Somerville, that Burns received this invitation to come and minister in St. Peter's. Exactly why? It seems to have been a secret that McChain took to the grave. People were surprised. His own elders were concerned that this boy 23 years old, just turning 24, should fill the pulpit of this giant, as they saw him already, Robert Murray McShane. And so on the second Sunday in April the 14th, 1839, 2 weeks after his 24th birthday, most students of seminaries probably don't graduate before their 24th birthday nowadays. So this helps us capture just how young these men were. Murray McShane was only a few years older. So just turned 24, he comes to St. Peter's and preaches his first sermon from Romans 12, 1 and 2, a sermon he had preached in his father's church just a couple of weeks previously, immediately after his licensing. Eiley Burns, who wrote his biography, his father's biography, was also McShane's successor. And so he had a good deal of intimate knowledge of what it was like when his brother had come. And he writes, "I've heard old members of the congregation tell how their hearts trembled for him when they saw what seemed to be a mere stripling standing up in the place of one whom they so revered and honored." And doubtless McShane looked older than those drawings of him you've seen. He was a sick man, whereas Burns was young and hale and hearty. But interestingly, whatever you make of this, McShane had some kind of premonition that it would be in his absence rather than in his presence that something fresh would happen in St. Peter's. He believed, he writes, "that a great blessing may come to my people in my absence, lest we say, my hand and my eloquence have done this." So thus far, with Burns being awakened, called into the ministry, arriving in St. Peter's. Now let's turn secondly to Burns and the awakening. And nothing could be more obvious, I think, from reading the biographies of both men and the comments by those who knew them both well, that they were totally different men. Burns from the relative modesty of a parish manse, McShane from the elite of Edinburgh. You can imagine even in accent, they were different. Scottish accents are being homogenized these days, but they weren't homogenized in my childhood. You could tell which side of Glasgow somebody came from, never mind whether they came from Edinburgh or Glasgow. McShane was aesthetic, Burns was rustic, physically strong and fit, an enormously powerful voice. Somebody who said about Burns, who had heard the great preachers of the 19th century, had lived long enough to hear Spurgeon, said that even Spurgeon's powerful voice was surpassed by the voice of the young Burns. So completely different men. And as far as I can discover, there are some at least in the room who know a lot more about this than I do, but as far as I discover, they may not have had a personal conversation before McShane actually invited him to come. Burns was present at a missionary meeting that McShane had spoken about a couple of years before that, profoundly impressed by the sense of Christ's indwelling McShane. But how all this came about in McShane's mind is, to me at least, something of a mystery, except the network. Burns' father had spent a session in St. Andrews at the same time as Chalmers was a student. In fact, at one point, Chalmers had turned to Burns Sr. and said, "You're a Calvinist. There aren't any others here in St. Andrews. You should come home and meet my father." And then Burns' older sister had married the brother of Alexander Moody Stewart. And then there was Rabbi Duncan. So there was a network of knowledge, and presumably it was out of that network of knowledge that McShane began to feel that Burns was the man. Well, one plants, another waters. God gives the increase. When Burns went to St. Peter's, he felt he was seeing a spiritual vitality in a congregation that he'd never actually witnessed before. So already there was a springtime under McChain's ministry, even although he had been sickly for the previous months. And something fresh began to happen. Get little indications of this. For example, he was 3 weeks in St. Peter's when he wrote, "I was, quotes, warned by Mrs. P." That's capital P. No, her name wasn't P, it was P something. "Warned by Mrs. P against the danger to which young ministers are exposed." You know, every vital church has a Mrs. P when young minister comes along. So what was the danger? Well, neither Burns nor Mrs. P recorded the wisdom for posterity. But it certainly sounds as though something was happening very quickly that Mrs. P felt might swell Burns' head. And this is perhaps underlined by something another lady said to him. The next week, he, elderly lady, he finds her reading the letters of Samuel Rutherford, and she says this to him about what's happening in the church. "The ways of God are strange. We mun just see what airt he takes." The ways of God are strange. Why is this happening when McChain is absent? Must have seemed very strange to those who loved him so much. And this is mirrored by an intense inner struggle that Burns records. He writes, "I discovered through grace an awful hungering after applause from man. Came home fearing that God may utterly forsake me in consequence of my self-seeking in his service." I think this is actually a real common experience in ministers who see something fresh happening. People hanging on our words. This strange combination of anything between appreciation and love, that you're at the center of it, and fear that you enjoy being appreciated and at the center of it. Again, he writes, "I had an affecting disclosure to myself of the pride and vanity of my heart, which praise of late has awfully stirred up." So clearly he was not experiencing what many of us have experienced. "That was fine, but you're nothing like Mr. So-and-so." Here he'd entered into McChain's ministry, and at least some of the congregation were, in a sense, unwisely raising him above McChain. And old Mrs. P was probably right to warn him. It's worth noting, I think, in passing, that Ernest Kevin, who was, I think, the first principal of the London Bible College, now the London School of Theology, used to tell his students there are two main sins in the ministry, and the first of them is pride. And Burns wrestled with this. Just as a parenthesis, when you reflect on that group of men, friends, in the McChain, Bonner, Burns, Chalmers circle, especially those contemporaries, it seems to me there were some real providential gifts of God that helped them stay together. One was that they knew one another before they were either licensed or ordained. Another was that they were really different from each other. No two of them the same. Even Horatius and Andrew Bonner, very differently wired. Providential that they recognized each other's gifts even before they were exercising a ministry. And even although some of them longed that the fruitfulness they saw in others might attend their ministry, in God's mercy, they were largely protected from those ministerial jealousies, which are very real, alas, that would have marred the work of God among them. That's not to say that by any stretch of the imagination they always agreed with each other. I think of the time when Andrew Bonner asked John Milne what he was going to preach on the Sabbath evening, and Milne gave him an outline of the sermon. Andrew Bonner said that that was very bad exegesis. And then when Milne was stiffened in his preaching, Bonner berated him afterwards by saying he was looking far too much to man during the course of the sermon, which led Milne to conclude, "I am never again going to tell anybody what I'm going to preach on before I actually preach it." So there was honest intercourse of mutual criticism and disagreement. Burns had been nurtured to long for a fresh outpouring of the Spirit. But what is interesting to me is, by contrast with situations probably many of us have been in, where people have an enthusiasm and a passion for a revival to come, Burns was not misdirected by that enthusiasm from the hard slog of gospel ministry. And the story of his life, all the way from St. Peter's onwards, is a story of, by and large, careful, disciplined, spiritual exercise, prayerfulness, ministry of the word, much visiting, much connectedness to people, caring for the sick and needy, and of course prayer. This was, above all other things, the thing that Burns' friends noticed about him. Even Eily Burns, his younger brother, comments, "His whole life was literally a life of prayer, and his whole ministry a series of battles fought at the mercy seat." The day before he began in St. Peter's, one of the elders took him round the parish, then took him to his home and showed him his room. And Burns didn't appear for ages. Then they found him still in the room, we're told, flat on his face, in prayer, pleading with God to accompany him in the ministry on the next day. And what is so interesting to me is that what people noted the next day was this extraordinary sense of poise there was about him. In fact, people noticed that all the way through his ministry. Horatius Bonner says, of all the people he knew, William Burns and John Milne were the most fearless people he'd ever seen. Nothing seemed to be able to intimidate them. And if you can imagine Burns later on in China, like a lone figure in China, doing and saying some of the most extraordinarily bold things, you catch a sense of this poise that governed his life, which in many ways was a balance to a completely different part of his personality. Well, how do we move from this point in Burns' life to the fact that he becomes the agent of something unusual that takes place in the latter part of 1839? It seems to me there are five moments in Burns' experience that lead to the unusual days that lay ahead. The first is, he tells us that he began to feel there was something lacking in his preaching in Dundee, and that he needed more, as he says, to throw down the gauntlet. Money McChain could be pretty direct. They said about him after he died, he could be even more direct face to face than he was in public, but he could be very direct in public. If anything, Burns became more direct. Application, exhortation, became key things in his preaching. So there was a transition in his preaching. The second thing was that he became convinced that he needed to change his mode of preparation for the pulpit. And this is something that kind of follows him all the way through his life. Sometimes it seems for better and sometimes it seems for worse. And he made the resolution that he would spend less time in technical preparation, in composing sermons, in that sense preparing to preach, less time doing that than in prayer. In a sense, he took at the foot of the letter, Acts 6:4, we will give ourselves to prayer and the ministry of the word. If you think about the amount of time that's spent in preparation of sermons, I mean, the man is only 24. This is a very remarkable thing, not only the commitment to do it, but the ability to do it. So there's something very unusual taking place in Burns' life. Moody Stewart makes a very interesting comment about him. Moody Stewart came to know him quite well, and of course, in a sense, was part of the family circle. And he says, in the period before the days of the awakening, Burns was full of prayer. He seemed to care for nothing but to pray. But then he makes this fascinating comment. He says, for a season, however, before the Kossuth communion, he seemed two different men in private and public. Now, if you hear that about yourself, you know you're not going to hear something complimentary. He's two different men. It's one thing in public and another thing in private. But listen to what Moody Stewart says. He says, his own spiritual strength so far exceeded what appeared in the pulpit. In this sense, he was an iceberg. And it was what was going on underneath as an individual that was the key thing. And all that Burns seemed to have noticed was there was an increased sense of solemnity in the worship services in St. Peter's. So something lacking in his preaching, something happening in the way in which he prepares for the pulpit. And then a third moment took place in mid-July. Burns was scheduled to take part in the Kossuth summer communion season. And just before it, his brother-in-law, Alexander Moody Stewart's brother, George Moody, his sister's husband, died in Paisley. The funeral took place on Thursday, July the 18th. Burns wrote about the beauty of Moody's life and the serenity of his death, but he especially recalled a moment that took place towards the end of the services of the day, and he wrote this. He says, on the way to the grave, I wept with joy and could have praised the Lord aloud for his love in allowing me to assist in carrying to the bed of rest a member of his own body, of his flesh and of his bones. And when I looked for the last time on the coffin body with its narrow, low, solitary, cold resting place, I had a glorious anticipation of the second coming of the Lord. Now, what I think is interesting here, and I think this is repeated throughout the history of the church, is much of this is not something to which Burns is aspiring. This is something that's happening to him. This is coming to him. And so he comes back to Kossuth to assist in the communion season. Back in Kossuth, his father had been encouraging the people to pray. There had been some measure of a sense of advance, more people being converted recently. On the Friday, July the 19th, Burns preached an old sermon, recent sermon from St. Peter's on Psalm 130, 1-2. And he says that he did this with considerable solemnity in a manner in some degree fitted to alarm unconverted sinners and sleeping saints. On the Saturday, he preached in nearby Banton on Psalm 130, verse 3, also a sermon that he had recently preached in St. Peter's. But it was this moment near the grave of his brother-in-law that signaled something, this sense of eternal realities, of the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, which of course was a considerable interest among these men. And then came a fourth moment. On the Saturday evening before the communion, he was praying with someone who was a seeker. And while they were praying, this woman came to faith, confessed Christ with her lips, believed in him in her heart, and was saved. And this was the first time in Burns' experience they had actually been there with somebody when they had transitioned from death to life. And it's possible to go through a whole ministry and people to be converted, but to be there when it happened. And he wrote, "This brought the work of the Spirit before me in a more remarkable and glorious form than I had before witnessed, and served at once to quicken my desires after and encouraged my anticipation of seeing more glorious manifestations of the Lord's saving strength." And you see, this is coming to him again, these aspirations. He preached again on the Sunday evening from Matthew 11, 28. Need I say once more, it was an old sermon he had preached already in St. Peter's. And at the end of that sermon, which he says was without remarkable assistance — he was always interested in remarkable assistance or remarkable effects — he felt an unusual stirring and a longing for the people to whom he was preaching. And although he was heading back to Dundee, he said he would stay on and preach to them in the marketplace on the Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock. And it was then that the fifth moment took place. Looking back on that morning, he wrote about the increase of these aspirations that had developed. And he pinpointed three things. He said he had an increased longing to see people converted. Second, he had an increased desire for the glory of God to be manifested. And thirdly, he had an increased sense of sorrow over the lost condition of those to whom he preached. Actually, this was another thing that his friends noticed about him, this combination of concern for people, longing simultaneously for the glory of God. And sure enough, on the Tuesday morning, an immense crowd gathered in the marketplace in Kilsyth, and Burns gave out the second version of Psalm 102, verse 13, and read the words, "Thou shalt arise, and mercy yet thou to Mount Zion shalt extend. Her time for favor, which was set, behold, is now come to an end." And he says it was the word "now" that touched his heart. And so he read from Acts chapter 2 without comment and preached his famous sermon on Psalm 110, verse 3, "Thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power." Very analogous to what was Jonathan Edwards' experience with his famous sermon, "Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God." He had preached it before, he preached it again. But when he preached it, first of all, in Northampton, it did not have anything like the same effect as he did when he preached it later. And the same was true of this sermon of Burns. He'd preached it before at an evening service in St. Peter's in May. And he commented at the end of the day about two things. The first was that £8, 10 shillings and sixpence was raised during the day for a congregational library, not an insignificant sum of money. And second, that he was more than usually assisted of the Lord all day long. The sermon outline was this: 3 points, other subdivisions. First of all, the people spoken of, "Thy people, are God's elect given to Christ by the Father." Second, the promise given by the Father to Emmanuel is, "Thy people shall be willing," under which he had three subpoints: willing to be saved by Christ's righteousness, willing to take on them his yoke, willing to bear his cross. And thirdly, the time of the fulfillment of the promise is the day of Emmanuel's power. "Your people will be willing on the day of your power," which is, you can see him drawing on Acts chapter 2, the day of Christ's exaltation to the Father, the day of the preaching of the word, the day when Christ crucified is at the center of the doctrine taught, and the day of the outpouring of the Spirit. He illustrated this by reference to the great story of John Livingstone at the Kirkashots Communion in 1630, preaching from Ezekiel 36, 26 to 27. And he concluded the message by urging on the crowd an immediate acceptance of Christ. The story of that sermon is, I think, pretty well known. What is interesting is that the father and both the sons have left records of what happened during the sermon, so that you get it, as it were, from the outside, from two different generations, and then from inside the eyes of Burns himself. If you'll bear with me, let me read you part of their accounts. Later on, his father, William Hamilton Burns, had to describe what happened to the Presbytery of Glasgow. He wrote, "Throughout the whole sermon, there was more than usual seriousness and tenderness pervading the hearers. But it was towards the close, when depicting the remarkable scene at Kirkashots on the Monday after the communion there in 1630, when under the preaching of Mr. John Livingstone, native of Kosyth, 500 were converted. It was then that the emotions of the audience became too strong to be suppressed. The eyes of most of the audience were in tears, and those who could observe the countenances of the hearers expected half an hour before the scene which followed. After reciting Mr. Livingstone's text, and when pressing upon his hearers the all-important concern of salvation, while with very uncommon pathos and tenderness, he pressed immediate acceptance of Christ, each for himself. When referring to the affecting and awful state in which he dreaded the thought of leaving so many of them, whom he saw probably for the last time, again and again, as he saw his words telling on his audience, beseeching sinners old and young to embrace Christ and be saved, when he was at the heights of his appeal with the words, 'No cross, no crown,' then it was that the emotions of the audience were most overpoweringly expressed. A scene which can scarcely be described took place." And then his father comments to the presbytery, "I have no doubt from the effects which have followed," of course there was much criticism, "from the effects which have followed, and from the very numerous references to this day's service, as the immediate cause of their remarkable change of heart and life, that the convincing and converting influence of the Holy Spirit was at that time most unusually and remarkably conveyed. For a time, the preacher's voice was quite inaudible. Remember, Edwards was not actually able to finish the sermon in Enfield. His voice was inaudible. A psalm was sung tremulously by the precentor and by a portion of the audience, most of whom were in tears." Here's how Eiley Burns describes it. "His manner, indeed, at first and through nearly one half of the discourse, was as usual calm, deliberate, measured, nor did he, I think, greatly diverge either in words or in sequence of thought from the line of the written discourse. But there was about him throughout an awful solemnity, as if his soul was overshadowed with the very presence of him in whose name he spoke. And as he went on, that presence seemed more and more to pass within him and to possess him, and to bear him along in a current of strong emotion which was, alike to himself and his hearers, irresistible. Appeal followed appeal in ever-increasing fervor and terrible energy, till at last, as he reached the climax of his argument and vehemently urged his hearers to fight the battle that they might win the eternal prize, the words 'No cross, no crown' pealed from his lips, not so much like a sentence of ordinary speech, but as a shout in the thick of a battle." And Eiley Burns especially commented on an illustration that Burns had used of a lifeboat coming to the side of a foundering vessel, and his brother calling out, "Are you in? Are you in? Flee for refuge to take hold of the hope set before you now and forever." And then we also have it through his own eyes. "During the whole of the time that I was speaking, the people listened with the most riveted and solemn attention and with many silent tears and inward groanings of the spirit. But at the last, their feelings became too strong for all ordinary restraints and broke forth simultaneously in weeping and wailing, tears and groans, intermingled with shouts of joy and praise from some of the people of God. The appearance of a great part of the people from the pulpit gave me an awfully vivid picture of the state of the ungodly in the day of Christ coming to judgment. Some were screaming out in agony. Others, and among those strong men, fell to the ground as if they'd been dead. And such was the general commotion that after repeating for some time the most free and urgent invitations of the Lord to a sinner's favorite Scottish text from Isaiah 55 and Revelation 22, I was obliged to give out a psalm, which was soon joined in by a considerable number, our voices being mingled with the mourning groans of many prisoners sighing for relief. Well, the meeting that started at 10 closed at 3, and another meeting was announced at 6 o'clock. 24 years old, and you've just seen this, Burns went back to his father's manse, went to bed and slept for an hour. Just most remarkable phenomenon. Some very interesting sidelights on that event. One was that before that particular sermon, his mother and his sister Jane, to whom he seemed to have been especially close, both urged him to, in his preaching, to avoid any harshness of speech or expression. And in particular, Jane, his sister, seemed to be concerned that he was in danger of losing something of the sweetness that had marked his preaching, in an unpleasant sternness. And he says, "I thank the Lord for their counsel." And then something else happened. Later in the day, Charles Brown, the brother of Jameson Fawcett and Brown, commentary fame, David Brown, and himself, an extremely able spiritual writer, preached at 8 o'clock. And when he was finished his sermon, Burns turned to Charles Brown and said, "I think we should continue the meeting." And the conversation seems to have gone like this: "So what do you mean, continue the meeting?" And Burns said, "I think we should speak to those who know they are not converted." And Brown, obviously very hesitant, seems to say, "Well, if that's what you think we should do, then do it." And so Burns called those who were unconverted to come, to stay. He spoke to them, urged them to accept Christ. The meeting went on till 2 o'clock in the morning. His father was up most of the rest of the night speaking to people who were concerned about their spiritual condition. Well, the meetings continued. Burns Sr. comments very sweetly that women were coming to the services, believe it or not, without their bonnets on, and men were coming in their working clothes. And night after night, this continued, and Burns was delayed from returning to St. Peter's for a couple of weeks. You can understand, especially if you think now, middle of the 19th century, Scotland, this country church, 4,000 people in Kilsyth, the idea that in that community you would call people forwards to stay because they know they're not converted was bound to raise reservation and criticism. Burns' own father was concerned about what was happening. The outbreak of emotion, the very fact that a 24-year-old boy minister was in the midst of this, bound to attract criticism. So this was not tidy. You know, sometimes in our prayer meetings, people pray for a revival and they think that they're talking about God coming to tidy up the church. It's never that way. Because the work of God is always exploding the deep places of our souls and bringing out to the surface our sinfulness. It was happening in Burns' own experience. The plug had been pulled out of the deep recesses of his desire for acceptance and pride and all the rest of it. So this was a very untidy business. Most of Burns' friends were called to fill in a questionnaire, and one of the questions was, do you approve of these meetings going on so late at night? And almost to a man, they replied, no. But then I remember that at least on one occasion, the Apostle Paul was still preaching at 12 o'clock at night, and somebody's life was endangered, which was the other thing, as rumors spread. People are dying, people are going off their heads. So this was not an easy passage for a 24-year-old man. And indeed, as McChain was returning to Dundee, Robert Candlish wrote to him and said, now, when you get back to Dundee, be very careful, be very cautious in the way in which you come to a judgment. I believe that there is a real work of God going on here, but be very cautious about how you assess it and make sure you suspend judgment. Well, in a sense, the story was repeated when Burns returned to Dundee. He came to the Thursday night meeting for prayer, and at the end of that meeting, you didn't need a Twitter account for news to travel from Kosyth to Dundee. People wanted to know what was happening. And he described what was happening. And he did the same thing that he had done in Kosyth. He urged those who knew they were not converted to remain behind so that he could press the gospel upon them. And about 100 remained so. Andrew Bonner describes what happened. Suddenly, he says, the power of God seemed to descend, and all were bathed in tears. It was like a pent-up flood breaking forth. Tears were streaming from the eyes of many, and some fell on the ground, groaning and weeping and crying for mercy. And then, thereafter, virtually every evening, meetings for worship, meetings for preaching. This is why McChain, others, are always sending little notes to each other when the mail could get through so quickly, apparently, in 1839, urging them, come tomorrow and preach for me, because they needed the help. Burns wanted to preach in the meadows in Dundee, and the magistrates wouldn't give him the opportunity, so he preached in the churchyard. Later on, the managers of St. Leonard's Church in Perth wanted to close the pulpit to him, and John Milne told the congregation the next Sunday, the day this pulpit is closed to William Chalmers Burns is the last day you see me in Perth. So there was an outbreak of spiritual enthusiasm on the one hand, and an outbreak of criticism. The lateness of the meetings, the psychological effects of the preaching. And so we find two things in the narrative developing. One is the way in which so many sober-minded ministers, whom I imagine most of us esteem, really believed that this was an authentic work of God. But whatever the untidiness, God had come in answer to prayer and was visiting and redeeming his people. And the second thing, of course, was that it wasn't without cost to Burns. A young man, he finds himself being derided in public, being destroyed in many ways by the press. And he lived with that for years to follow in Scotland. The press despised him. He was said to be, quotes, a silly-looking lad with a sort of meaningless simper on his face. They wrote in the pulpit he could be seen jumping up like a jack-in-the-box or looking at the congregation with a self-complacent smile. One commentator on his ministry from Perth wrote that his words were, quotes, daring blasphemy. He is a scandal on religion and a disgrace to our city. There is something in his manner which, whatever it may be now, must originally have been pure affectation. And he goes on to complain. He says, go into a dog kennel and raise a particular whine, and the chance is that you are soon joined by the whole pack, especially if there are many puppies present. Mr. Burns must know these things and be well acquainted, listen to this, must be well acquainted with the character and temperament of the women who chiefly follow him. Yet he persists in attributing the wails and cries of excited and hysterical females to the direct operation of the deity. He didn't take the time to ask William Burns Sr. what had happened to the miners in Kilsyth, who from cursing when they were down the pits had come to spend their break time praying together for the conversion of their friends. So easy a target. Be not as the hypocrites, said the press. And so in another account, this is one of the most deplorable exhibitions of misguided enthusiasm and moral insanity which could possibly be imagined. Well, if I go on, I will try your patience. So let me move on to this third section, Burns Awakened, Burns and the Awakening. And then Burns the Awakener. And let me try and abbreviate the next hour into just giving you five or six headings that strike me as worthy of our reflection. The first is this, that Burns' life illustrates a very common spiritual principle, that God shapes for service, shapes his servants for service, often in the womb from which they are regenerated. Or to put it another way, the experiences that surround an individual's regeneration and conversion often mark the whole of that individual's ministry. And actually, it's a pretty important principle to recognize that this is true, lest we seek to clone ministers. And this is obviously true of Burns, that part of his conversion narrative is this shocking disclosure to him of his own sinfulness. And a big element in the early narrative of his spiritual growth is the way in which God seems to dig down with increasing depth to show him that actually his sinfulness is woven not just into his weaknesses, but into his very best gifts. I mean, it was, after all, Isaiah, who presumably was the best preacher in Jerusalem, who must have gone to his friend Jacob afterwards and said to Jacob, I have discovered I am a man of unclean lips. And what would we say to him? We'd say, you know, maybe we need to get the elders to put some money together, send him on a holiday. He's overwrought. Very uncomfortable. But this is a great principle, I think, that we need to take note of in ourselves and in others, lest we think that the wind always blows from the same direction and in the same way. And so this tremendous sense of his own sinfulness, the shock of a morally upright individual externally discovering that he is dead in trespasses and sins, that he's following the course of this world, that he's a prisoner to the prince of the power of the air. Major element in his ministry. Second thing that his friends noticed, and we've noticed this afternoon, and on which especially those of us who are or seek to be ministers should think, I think, long and hard. I have not met many ministers who have told me, I wish I'd preached more, but I've met a lot of ministers who have said, I really regret I did not pray more. And Burns, by God's grace, discovered that early on in his life and truly became a living prayer, a man of prayer, pleading with God, intercession, worshipping God, being consciously in God's presence. Thirdly, I think there is a great deal to learn from the fact, and you need to read the biography and the biographies of the men who were part of this network to realize the extent to which Burns lived as a personal witness to Christ. He didn't seem to go anywhere without carrying tracts with him. Now, that's 19th century. Tract writing is neither popular, nor are people very good at, and they become more expensive to produce. But he never went anywhere to have a conversation without knowing at the end of that conversation, even if he never saw the person again, his witness could continue in their lives. He lived an evangelistic life. The fourth thing that I think is really worth noting, especially in a theological seminary, is that we should take note of the way in which he cultivated a network of friends. I was reading fairly recently a book by the American, he's a Christian American sociologist, John Davidson Hunter. And Hunter argues there, along with a number of sociologists, just on the human level, that the thesis of idealism about how things change, how a culture changes, is that they change through the proliferation of ideas. And Hunter is saying, actually, that's really a form of Hegelianism and idealism, that it's purely ideas that change things. And he argues that if you look at events in history, yes, there is the kind of Thomas Carlyle, heroes and hero worship, the great man, the Julius Caesar, if you want to call him a great man, or let's say Winston Churchill in some of our day, is what you need to look for is the network. Because the individual has no traction unless there is the network. And this was certainly true of Burns and that group of men. There was a real network. And the interesting thing is, when you think of how young they were when they were at the forefront of this movement, that network had been especially forged in their lives when they were students. The church history lectures in this institution are not like going into the cave of Morpheus, okay? The Hebrew professors know more than a little Hebrew. But what you learn in the lecture room is it as much as half of your education? Isn't it just as important if we're called to gospel ministry that there are bonds of mutual affection forged among us and within us that will last throughout our whole ministry? And that was a great element in this. This was a kind of school of the prophets. This was a group of disciples. And we should value these realities especially. And then when you think about the way in which that actually has been true. In 2009, I was reading a lot for a variety of reasons, not just about Calvin's theology, but about who Calvin knew. The range and depth of his friendships, absolutely astonishing. That brotherhood, that network. If you think of the Puritan brotherhood and the interconnectedness among the names you know, they all seem to have either known each other, been converted through one another, or been helped through one another's ministries. And think of the same thing among the eclectics in the Church of England. Or that group of Scots who corresponded with Jonathan Edwards, or the circle here. And to think that God might do a new thing in the future in our own country through a new network of brothers who are utterly committed to him, and who incidentally, for all they knew about the grim book drill, they were extraordinarily diligent students. They really wanted to be able to handle God's word well. The fifth thing that's worth commenting on is that Burns was not normal. Now, when did you last meet a normal minister? We have three boys and a girl. My daughter's a forensic psychiatrist. I happened to say foolishly in her presence once, "Ruth, I'm quite normal." She sat me down. "I'm medically qualified to tell you, Dad, you are not normal." none of us is normal. Burns really was not kind of normal in some ways. I mean, how many of you are going to read the Greek classics for relaxation? How many of you with an adrenaline rush of preaching to a large crowd of people, be able to go back, put your head on the pillow and fall to sleep? He was very unusually wired. And then he had this, as his brother says, the phrase that comes to mind is miles expeditus. That is the category of Roman soldier who was ready to go at a moment's notice. When they asked him in, I think it was Sunderland, before he went out to China, and they ordained him as a missionary to China, and said, when will you be ready to go? He said, tomorrow. He would just turn up in places with his little carpet bag. He was sitting with John Milne in the St. Leonard's Manse in Perth when Andrew Bonner appeared, and Burns was scheduled to preach that night, and Burns got up and said, I'm going to Dundee to preach. And they said, you can't go to Dundee to preach, you're preaching here tonight. He said, no, I'm going to Dundee. And they said, you're not only preaching here tonight, you're advertised to preach here tonight. People are expecting you to preach tonight. And he just walked up and went out. If there are other people who can do it, that's not normal. That's awkward. Some people can get away with it. But don't do that kind of thing if you're preaching in St. Peter's, if you're sitting in David Robertson's manse, 5:30 in the evening. But those are the, you know, we should love people's eccentricity, shouldn't we? And that brings me on to the final point I want to make. And that is, I think it's really worthwhile, especially in the zeitgeist at the moment, to reflect on Burns as a preacher. And if I can be a marginal irritant in this, I don't know if I'm irritating anyone by saying these things, I want to just make three points about Burns as a preacher by borrowing from the antithesis of Matthew 5, 21 to 48. You have heard that it was said, but. So here are three things I have heard it said, but. William Chalmers Burns. And happily, we don't have time to discuss them. The first is this. I'd love to read you all these accounts of Burns as a preacher, but I must desist. Here's the first thing. You have heard it said, don't preach your theology. But William Chalmers Burns did. He did when he preached from Psalm 110, verse 3. He didn't think that the exegesis of the text was preaching. He thought exegesis might be teaching, but it wasn't kerygma. And kerygma demands theology. And you can see that in that sermon and in all of the sermons of the brethren in those days. So I have heard it said, don't preach your theology. And I think Burns might have said, what else is there to preach? He might even have been bold enough to say, or am I just putting the thought into his heavenly head? If my exegesis of the text doesn't raise me from the text to the one who is the subject matter of the text, then I'm engaged in a kind of textual idolatry, a kind of unreformed unbiblical bibliolatry. So I've heard it said, don't preach your theology, William Chalmers Burns, whom I mentally am constantly calling Robert Murray McShane. William Chalmers Burns obviously did. And if you think you should never preach your theology, you should ask the question, Is there something in his ministry that's lacking in mine? The second thing is this. You've heard it said that the most effective way to preach is by systematic, consecutive exposition. Burns could do that, sometimes did do that, but he didn't usually do that. And I think we probably in our time need to hear that. Not least because Burns' hour and a half long sermons have become half hour sermons. And many of those sermons in consecutive, systematic, consecutive expository preaching are taken up with the explanation of the text and little with the application, little with the doctrine of the text, little with the application of the text, little with the old-fashioned uses of the text, very little with exhortation. And teaching the text is not quite the same thing. Let me put this, I shouldn't ascribe this to Burns, this is purely Ferguson. I don't think Paul's preach the word in 2 Timothy 4 can mean systematic, consecutive exegesis of the Old Testament. Maybe the apostles did that. There's not a shred of evidence that that was the way they did it. And what they emphasize, you'll notice, is the scriptures are, notice the connection between the end of 2 Timothy 3, beginning of 2 Timothy 4, is the way you preach is by using the scriptures for what the scriptures were given, for teaching, correcting, rebuking, training in righteousness. What is the thing that tends to drop out in systematic, consecutive exposition? Well, I do it a lot, but what is it that drops out? It tends to be the rebuking and the correcting, which involves the application and the transition and the uses and the right answering of how does Scripture teach us to do this, and how is it that we appeal to every man's conscience in the sight of God. And since systematic, consecutive exposition has become de rigueur, I think it's worth asking the question of ourselves, is that going to be the best means for us to preach the whole counsel of God? And speaking purely for my own part, I'm pretty convinced that not all ministers are wired to be at their best for their people when they're doing that. And sometimes it takes years doing that to get to issues that needed to be dealt with 3 years before. And so we mustn't in the contemporary zeitgeist assume that the new tradition of the late 20th century, by and large, in most churches, goes right back to either the fathers of the church or the apostolic period. And then the third thing. You've heard that it was said, as I have, there is no such thing as unction. And W.C. Burns and his friends believed that there was. If I may be an irritant at this point, I've sometimes wondered when I've heard people in response to the question, is there such a thing as unction, not even discussing the question, just a kind of blasé no. I've often wondered, I wonder if anyone who sits under your ministry of the word would ever be so deluded as to think there was unction on the preaching. And here we are dealing with people who saw things as, whatever the untidiness was, whatever you might think about the unwisdom or the wisdom of the quotes means that Burns used, they were at one in this. that just as Jesus was anointed to preach, there is such a thing, a reality, however difficult it is to define. It's difficult to define regeneration, isn't it? It's really, you can put it in the abstract theological categories, but to define it? Well, it's not easy to define the work of the Holy Spirit by definition. And I think it is at least worth raising the question whether the contemporary conviction that there is no such reality as unction emerges from a season in which we have rarely seen it and ourselves rarely experienced it. So sometimes when I'm sitting in St. Peter's against the wall, I wish that the modern technology that is able to put microphones and recording devices in the wall had been there in 1839, and to have been able to hear William Chalmers Burns and out the corner of my eye see Robert McChane, as he says, sitting listening to him, and being profoundly impressed by Burns's humility and saying, "I trembled as I listened to the ministry of the Word." Because at the end of the day, it's when we tremble before the Word that the Lord seems to be pleased to bless us. Well, thank you for listening so patiently. I've appreciated the opportunity. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the story of the church, for the marvels of your ways. We are men and women who have heard with our ears, and our fathers have told us of the work that you did in their day, in days of old. And we acknowledge, as we seek to fulfill all our duties and responsibilities of the faithful ministry of your word, that our means are nothing unless they be attended by the supernatural power of your Holy Spirit. And we especially pray this afternoon for our brothers here whose calling is to preach your word, to pastor your people, that even while here, some measure of the grace of the fellowship that these men, almost 200 years ago now, experienced, they may experience too. Quicken within them, we pray, a desire to study and be faithful, and help them to become men of prayer, and give them courage, enable them to live in a divinely given rhythm of hard labor and sweet rest, and use them, we pray, for your glory. And we pray all of this in our Savior Jesus Christ's name.